I'm here with Alexander Mercurius, editor-in-chief of the Duran. Alexander, we got to talk about the coronavirus and what's happening in China and all over the world as this virus is spreading. The last count, as to what I've seen on the internet today, Sunday evening here, is that you have over 2,000 people infected. In China, it has been spreading now to the US, to Australia, to Canada. I believe Russia will be reporting their first cases very soon as well. Malaysia, Mexico, I heard, may actually be reporting some cases as well. It's spreading, and it's spreading very fast. To put some things into context, we have over 2,000 cases right now reported. SARS back in 2003 topped out at around 8,000 infections with 749 deaths, I believe. So we can see that the rate of growth for the coronavirus is, moving very, very quickly. Let me read you some more stats via Zero Hedge, which is doing some really excellent coverage of what's going on. And they have a quick summary, a bullet point summary. Alexander, 2,082 cases, 56 official deaths. Once again, that's Sunday night. Incubation is asymptomatic, contagious, and can be as long as 14 days. 5 million may have left Wuhan for the Lunar New Year. This is a very busy time, a travel time in China as well. It's the Lunar New Year, which is their big holiday. The first case was December 1st, not December 31st. So infected population may be much bigger. US, Russia, Thailand have begun plans for evacuation. In other words, they're evacuating diplomats and personnel from Wuhan and from China. Premier Li Qiangyang charged with leading the government's task force, and you have three Beijing hospitals are now using AIDS drugs to treat the virus. Alexander, what is the geopolitical, the economic fallout from this? What is China doing? It seems that they're not handling this very well once again. It seems they are behind the curve. A little better, actually, a lot better than the way they handled SARS, which they essentially tried to cover up. But we still don't have as much transparency as to what's going on here. And I think this is once again going to hurt the Chinese government. What's going on here? What's your take?
Well, it is good to have China because, of course, you're quite right. They are still well behind the curve. I mean, what clearly happened was that this epidemic, this a coronavirus epidemic, began in Wuhan. Wuhan is an important provincial capital and transport hub. Large numbers of people pass through it, not just to stay there, but just basically to go from one part of China to another. It's a sort of key transport and economic hub. And as you rightly say, this all happened around the start of the Chinese New Year celebrations. So there's an awful lot of movement of people, millions of people moving around. So the Chinese government is struggling to get control on this. And of course, they've taken some extraordinary measures. They've basically put the whole of Wuhan, where they started, under quarantine, and they're trying to track down all the infected cases. But of course, there are problems with doing that because those infected cases, there may be many, many, many more of them than the Chinese government knows. And trying to locate everybody who's been infected and then has passed on that infection is extremely difficult. And we're dealing with one of those viruses which is evolving all the time. So it seems up to now, though we're still at very early stages, that this disease, it's a kind of pneumonia type flu, is at its early stages of evolution. And we can't really know how dangerous it's going to be. But for the moment, it does seem to be less dangerous than SARS. But the concerns have to be enormous. And it's China that has to bear the brunt of this, and which is struggling to control this problem, and which has already had to take a major economic hit because of the steps it's had to take to close down Wuhan, which, as I said, is already a key transport hub. If this spreads across China, it will affect China's economic growth and its economic performance And that will have bigger implications for the world economy as well. But at the moment, it is China that is at the center of all of this. Now, can I just explain a little bit about what it seems the origins of these viruses is? And this relates both to the coronavirus and to SARS and to other viruses, new viruses that have come out of China. It seems that this is an animal virus. It exists in animals. And the likelihood, this is what happened with SARS, and the likelihood is that it spread to humans from humans eating infected food in Chinese markets. In Chinese markets, they still eat things like snakes and bats and things like this, which is still a part of Chinese cuisine in some regions of China. Not in the main urban centers, not in Beijing or Shanghai or whatever, wherever. But it seems that hygiene conditions in some of these Chinese markets may not be quite what they ought to be. And these creatures, bats and especially apparently, are receptacles of many, many types of diseases. So, and they're wild. They are wild animals. And the way you cook animals is wild animals is problematic. So it seems that there is this problem that they do, can leap from wild animal populations into human populations at these markets, and it's partly because particularly elderly Chinese apparently are still suspicious of refrigeration, and in markets in provincial centres like Wuhan. And remember, it's the New Year, so lots of people going there and buying things. They like to buy very fresh food, and they buy these kind of animals, which are not widely eaten elsewhere. So that's, it seems, why it originates in China. And the Chinese authorities are now finally, it seems, taking steps to prohibit the eating of some of these animals in order to try to stop or check the spread of these viruses. And I predict, by the way, when all this ends, when we do finally get on top of this particular virus, that will become a permanent thing. So it's unsurprising that it's originated in China because of this history, as I said, of people buying these fresh animal products in markets in places like Wuhan. But it's also the case that perhaps no other country in the world has the kind of political and social tools to confront this disease in the way that China does. I mean, imagine in the United States closing down a whole big city, St. Louis or wherever, New Orleans or wherever, just absolutely placing it in entire quarantine in this fashion. It would be a radical, it is a radical step, but the Chinese government has the power to do it. Now, I have to say, there is a huge difference between the way in which the Chinese government is covering this story as opposed to SARS. SARS, as you rightly said, they took the usual old reaction of trying not to report it and to try to downplay it. On this occasion, it's been widely publicized in China. Chinese media is full of it. It's the big story there, and people are the authorities are taking it extremely seriously. And Xi Jinping, the Chinese leader, has spoken out about it. So obviously, they've still got a lot to learn. They're far behind the curve, but they are trying to the extent that they can to get on top of the problem. And let's hope they do, because these epidemics, if they do spread around the world, they can be devastating. I mean, the death rate from SARS, I believe, was around 4% of infected people. And, that is a very high death rate from these kind of infections, which can be very, very serious. Also, the extreme case, the famous one, is the Spanish influenza that spread around the world just after the First World War, and which appears, by the way, to have originated in the United States. And far more people died as a result of the Spanish influenza epidemic of 1919 and 1920 than died in the First World War, fighting in the First World War itself. So it gives you an idea of how devastating these epidemics can be if they get out of control. Now, obviously, we have far more advanced medical knowledge than we did in the 1920s, but communications are so much better. So it's going to be a titanic struggle to get on top of it. But the Chinese, as I said, the Chinese authorities do have resources which other governments perhaps don't.
Okay, well, let me read you a tweet, Alexander, which also puts some things in perspective as to how dire the situation is and how quickly this virus is spreading. Wuhan Mayor Zhou Zhanwang is now hosting a press conference in Wuhan. Quote, 1,000 new cases of coronavirus are expected in Wuhan at the moment. Many netizens are outrageous about the slow reaction of the local government over the outbreak and ask him to take responsibility for it. I point that out because it seems that with each day that passes, we're getting thousands and thousands of more new cases, and many people are saying that the Chinese government is downplaying the severity of the situation. In other words, we're hearing 2,500. This Wuhan mayor is saying you have 1,000 more cases, and many people are estimating that within a week's time, we could be looking at 100 to 200,000
Yes.
infected cases. Now, I'm glad that you also mentioned the origins of this virus because there are some alternative
Yeah.
Interpretations and theories as to how this came about. And anyone that is watching this video, that is a scientist,
Yeah.
a biologist, a chemist, you're in that field, please put your comments down below and let
Absolutely.
us know what you think. But
Absolutely.
some of the other theories, Alexander, range from this was a bioweapon.
Yeah.
How is that an actual laboratory, a bioweapons laboratory located 20 miles outside of Wuhan, and it kind of got loose? We've heard that. We've also heard stories that this was actually a bioweapon in Canada, in a Winnipeg laboratory, Canada's National Microbiology Laboratory, one of the best in the world. And it was infiltrated by Chinese agents who then, for lack of a better word, smuggled the virus back to China and it got loose. So you have that theory as well going around. And you also have the theory that this was a man-made virus kind of thrown into the environment because the pharmaceutical companies, and I've heard anywhere from Bezos to Gates to big pharmaceuticals actually have the cure for this, and they're just kind of letting this, kind of move out there and spread, and then they're just going to come up with the cure. And I say this because H5N1 or H1N1, whatever happened 3 years ago, that was a man-made virus. And they had that Tamiflu cure in inventory sitting there and they couldn't sell that. So I'm convinced that that was a man-made virus and they just wanted to unload that inventory, the pharmaceuticals. There's no doubt about it. That was a man-made virus, and they needed to offload all that inventory of Tamiflu, and they did it. So, give us your thoughts as to all the things that I have said. What about the mayor of Wuhan and the alternative theories as to how this started?
Well, let's begin with the mayor of Wuhan and with the ch response of the Chinese authorities. I mean, I've been looking at the Chinese media. I see no sign or evidence there that anybody's trying to cover this story up. On the contrary, the Chinese media and the Chinese authorities are covering the story extensively. It seems to be the big story in China, and they're very concerned about it. Having said that, there will always be criticisms. And it's inevitable that there will be criticisms, and some of those criticisms may be fully justified. One mustn't assume that everything is always done perfectly by in every situation, and that's why you need criticisms so that you can identify things that are being done wrong and where mistakes are being made. It is unsurprising that people in Wuhan, who must be extremely frightened, are lashing out at their own regional government at the moment and are criticizing them for not coping effectively with this crisis and that this criticism may spread towards to the Chinese central government too. It's completely unsurprising that that is happening, and it's in the nature of these sort of problems. And that's not to say, as I said, that the Chinese government is responding perfectly, but I don't get the impression at all that they're trying to downplay it or cover it up. And I'm sorry to say, though, that at the rate this thing is spreading, 100,000 infections, in a couple of weeks is by no means impossible. I hope we don't get there, but it's by no means impossible that we do. Now, as to all these other theories, I'm going to run for the moment with the theory that it started in a market, in the way that I said that it's not a bioweapon. I don't understand the technology of how these bioweapons are supposed to have been created. If somebody can explain it to me, then I'd be grateful and I'd be very interested to know. I mean, I don't have that kind of scientific background. All I would say is the Chinese authorities are not saying that at the moment. And as we say, extraordinary theories require extraordinary evidence. And at this moment in time, I don't really see the evidence for those theories. So I'm going to run with the market theory at the moment. I think the idea that it all originated in Canada and was smuggled into China from Canada, that seems to me, frankly, far-fetched. Doesn't mean it's untrue, but I mean, I have to say that. I mean, it does seem far-fetched to me. The idea that it leaked out of a Chinese weapons laboratory, I frankly am skeptical. I wouldn't have thought that such a laboratory anyway would be cl connect closely located near to a big city in that kind of fashion. And as I understand it, attempts to, invent synthetically viruses like this and use them as bioweapons have not been terribly successful. But I'm happy to be told, have it explained to me by scientists otherwise. As for the fact that some of the chemicals and drugs companies have or that they do produce these illnesses in order to make lots of money by selling drugs to combat them. I'm sorry to say I'm willing to believe anything of some drugs companies. I've had experience. I was very, very ill at one time, and I was given a drug which did me huge harm. So, I'm far from being somebody who's going to say the drugs companies don't do those sort of things. On the contrary, I'm sure they do. But I haven't seen the evidence in relation to this one, this case. So for that reason, I'm going to run with the theory that it began in the way that I said, with a crossover from animals to humans, probably arising from eating of infected food in bought in a Chinese market, in infected wild food. This is the theory the Chinese authorities seem to be working with, and it seems to be how the SARS virus took hold all those years ago. But by all means, if people know have expert knowledge about this and can explain it to us better, then I second what Alex said. We absolutely welcome interventions and explanations of that kind.
Yeah, this reminds me of the bioweapons factory being located, or a laboratory being located 20 miles out of the city. When you were talking, it kind of, reminded me of the Novichok incidents, where I think you did have a laboratory
Oh yeah, we do,
that actually housed Novichok, which was right outside the city limits. And that was one of the theories being floated as to how the Novichok, got into the Skripals.
absolutely. You're referring
Into their home, or into on their doorknob, or wherever they found it.
to Porton Down, which is in fact Britain's primary laboratory for dealing with for producing chemical and biological and those kind of weapons. It's the main research center for those sort of things. Of course, the British would say that because they're signatories to the the Chemical Weapons Convention, Porton Down doesn't produce those kind of weapons anymore. it's only involved in researching how to counter them. That's what the British will say. But Portendown has had a long history of coming up with all kinds of strange and interesting weapons. And it is, in fact, a major laboratory. And it is indeed located very close to Salisbury, where the Skripal incident happened. And it was indeed linked by many people to those particular incidents. All I will say about that is Portendown has existed for a very long time. It is a decades-old factory, and it was set up when I think people, the authorities, would have been less concerned or aware of the dangers of setting up factories like this so close to major population centres. I think nowadays, I think the Chinese authorities would be more careful. And in a country like China, where there are vast open spaces, if you wanted to set up a laboratory doing that kind of work, well, there are places in the Gobi Desert or in Xinjiang province or wherever, or in Manchuria, where you could do it. And you could do it with much more control over it than you would do it if it was set up close to a big city like Wuhan. But that's just my thoughts. I mean, you know, if other people are better informed, I'm fully willing to listen.
Yeah, as we've been speaking, Alexander, there's been a fifth case confirmed in the U.S. in Los Angeles. Senator Schumer, this is via The Hill, Senator Schumer, quote, all CDC has to do is declare the coronavirus an emergency, and that will spring up to $85 million. That's immediately available to prevent the spread. And CBS Los Angeles, just in, the Los Angeles County Department of Public Health has confirmed the first case of the novel coronavirus in Los Angeles County. So it is spreading, $85 million in emergency funds. I mean, the implications for this are huge if it really spreads.
Absolutely. And I would
in all facets.
Absolutely. It is going to be, it would be a huge event if it spreads. And by the way, I predict that the US authorities will announce a state of emergency very soon, so that $85 million is released very quickly. I'm sure that they will do it.
Do you think the EU is going to follow suit? Do you think the UK is going to follow suit?
Oh, yeah.
Canada, sure. Australia?
Yes.
Russia?
I think so. I think the Russians are already working in that direction. Again, I've been following the Russian media coverage of this, and they are very concerned about it too. At the moment, everybody is hoping that the Chinese will get on top of this. But I think it's possible that we're already past that point.
Do you prohibit flights from China, all these countries? Do they prohibit air travel from China?
Well, they haven't done that yet.
Is that
knows?
Something you do?
You can do it. It might happen. We'll see. I mean, the implications of doing something like that are immense. I would have thought that before they take those kind of steps, they will hope that there are some ways of identifying the virus in people before they travel. But who knows?
All right. Alexander Mercurius, Editor-in-Chief of The Durant. Thank you very much, guys. If you like this video, click on the subscribe button down below. Click on the notifications bell. Also hit that like button as well. Please donate to us on PayPal, Patreon, and Subscribestar. Your donation really helps this channel a whole lot. And download the Telegram app and subscribe to our channel on Telegram. Alexander, people can go to the Durant shop and pick up some magic mugs and some great shirts, polo shirts, and other merchandise.
This is my oldest Durant mug. This is the very first one I got with the double-headed eagle of the Durant on it, which is our own distinctive double-headed eagle. Which looks to the east and west so that we can cover stories everywhere. I've had this mug now for, well, I think about a year, and you can see that it's in perfect condition, even though I drink from it so heavily. And it is beautiful and strong and light, and it keeps my hot tea hot. I've almost finished drinking from it now, so it's almost empty. But they are wonderful magic mugs. We've got lots of them. We are incredibly proud of them. They're beautifully made. They're light and strong. They don't chip or crack or break. They don't discolor if you put them in the dishwasher. They are marvelous magic mugs. I love drinking from mine. And I would strongly recommend them to anybody. If you really want to have a nice, good mug, you can't do better than our magic mugs. And as Alex has said on many occasions, it keeps us going through the long winter nights as we research programs, and so that we can come along and provide you with our analysis and our thoughts day in, day out, on the Duran. So you are supporting the Duran by buying them too, and you're owning these marvelous magic mugs and treating yourself to them if you buy them. And of course, it's not just magic mugs in our shop. We have our range of shirts, like this amazing polo shirt that I'm wearing, with also you can see the Duran double-headed eagle there, and all 100% cotton, all extremely stylish. These polo shirts in particular, in my opinion, are exceptionally stylish, and I wore them without any kind of hesitation, and indeed with great effect to all kinds of social occasions. But you can also wear them, in your home, as I'm doing at the moment. And we've also got long sleeve t-shirts and short sleeve t-shirts and V-neck shirts, and they're all 100% cotton, and they look amazing, and they're way amazing to wear. They're supremely comfortable, and they work in all weathers. And I've also been wearing my shirts now for many months, perhaps almost a year, and they're all in pristine condition, which shows you how well made they are. We don't just have shirts, we also have hoodies and hats and stickers. You buy all these things in our shop. It's a great range of products there. And if you buy from our shop, you own these great things and you support us. So don't hold back, own these great things, be the proud owner, support the Duran too. Alex will tell you how to do it.
You'll find a link for the Durant Shop, durantshop.com, in the description box down below. Alexander Mercuris, editor-in-chief of the Durant, thank you very much. Until next time, everybody, take care.